Hello everyone, welcome to an analysis of Dance, where we discuss the movements and debuts of the Billboard.
Hello everyone, how's it going? It's the MotoViews here, and I'm sorry I haven't been too active making videos this year. I've been quite fortunate enough to have a bit of time out for myself and see some certain areas of the world. And currently I'm in Australia looking for a job, and I just happened to come across this motherfucker in a random club somewhere. And honestly, 2023, I've really enjoyed it for music this year. Now, I did wonder if it was biased because I personally had a good year, but I think it's more the case that the music that got big is just the kind of genres that I generally like. You know, Afrobeats, drum and bass, even a bit of amapiano towards the end. And also some of the stuff, the more annoying genres from last year didn't really do too well. Like, we didn't really have a proper piano house hit this year, which is quite nice. We didn't even have a piano ballad make it big.
As for me, I'm very much in the same sort of realm with 2023, especially as a dance listener. This year has been absolutely phenomenal for dance music. The stuff I like Tech House, also had a really good year. Rise of Fred Again definitely changed the scene for the good in terms of the UK. Yeah, going through the year-end list for the UK and all the songs that peaked relatively high, it was a really interesting year. There was a lot of diverse stuff across the board, and I could not complain at all to be doing this with Modi here today, but unfortunately we have to discuss the worst of it, so
Excited, you know. And also, another advantage of getting this video out now instead of waiting until May, which is by coincidence, a lot of the stuff that I personally didn't like was stuff that charted fairly early on in the year and didn't last a long time. Rules for this list are the same as last year, so top 40 peak and spent 4 weeks in the top 100, and yeah, I can't wait to get on with it. Yeah, so let's go.
To it, man. So anyways, hello everyone. Welcome to an analysis of I've been trying to give it to you all night. What's it gonna take to get you all alone? So okay, little rant incoming. There's some stupid things with this particular song that I just cannot for the life of me understand. I know this was a video about the UK charts, but Billboard in all of their wisdom decided that this was dance music, making it one of the biggest dance songs of 2023, even despite only charting there when the album came out and not sounding remotely like it. Now, it would be one thing if the song was actually good, but fuck me, this shit sucks. Give me what I like, trying to ask tonight. That only you can satisfy. I mean, seriously, hasn't Better Off Alone been decimated enough already? Just in this year, we've had a shitty Jonas Blue and Sam Feld collab, and somehow Vicstar came out looking the best with his collab with Alan Walker and Dash Berlin themselves that actually sampled the same song. But by far the worst case was Alone, a drill collab between well-acclaimed enabler Nicki Minaj and equally as well-spoken upcoming pop artist Kim Petras. Now, I don't like this. The production sounds flat and cheap, the sample is integrated awfully on the hook and sounds really forced. Kim Petras has absolutely no personality to speak of, and Nicki Minaj delivers one of her laziest verses to date. Hit me back, Nicki ready, yes we rap. We throw jabs, bitch I get dragged, we be like gagged. But it really just bothers me that this of all songs was the only hit from Kim Petras since Unholy, because Feed the Beast actually has some decent deep cuts in there, and her recent collab with David Guetta is actually really damn good, but this is just ugly and really embarrassing to revisit all these months later.
This is the most recently eligible song on the list. It entered the charts in October and hit the top 40 just a couple weeks before recording. I don't know whether this will end up becoming bigger in 2024 or not, but either way, I'm not waiting until next year, because despite its recent popularity, it is the most bizarrely dated thing I heard this entire year, and I want to rant about it. Money like a punch bag, roughing it up. See, let me stick it in a ringer, yeah, I doubled it up. Don't you know the government are locking us up? So why the fuck you trying to act like you're up in a club? So there's this style of dance music. I don't know if it really has a name. Like, it's sometimes I call it Love Island core, although that's probably too general of a term. It's this kind of like hip housey thing where usually white rappers will rap shitty hedonistic bars over these very simple, rather mid-paced house beats with a bit of garage and bassline influence. Usually the song has a sample for the chorus. Often the music videos are a bit more similar to US rap videos with the hot models and flexing of jewelry, which you don't normally see in other UK hip hop vids. You know, think like Tom Zanetti, Silky. I was thinking that this genre was starting to die away, but then last winter, Bugsy Malone of all people made one of these songs out of nowhere and basically showed the white boys how it was done, showing there's still an audience for this. And Now we have Kaka.
Tell her don't fuck about, get straight to the point. Cut the potato sugars to the steak and the joint.
I will admit that my knowledge on the genre is nowhere near as strong as Mode's here, mainly because us Aussies rarely get this stuff charting or played on the radio here. But even with that, this sounds really badly produced, the vocals are very obnoxious and not in a fun way, and even by the standards of trashy hip house songs, this ain't anywhere near as fun as Don't You Worry About Me or any number of other UK hits of this style. Hell, if you're coming from another country where this sort of trashy bogan rap mixed with house music is popular with acts like Hooligan Hefts, this shit is nowhere near as fun or even remotely stupid in the charming way as that guy is. Just utterly worthless and not remotely enjoyable for me.
You guys remember the COVID lockdowns, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this song was released on the 10th of January 2021. And for those who don't know or forgot, on the 5th of January, Bojo announced the UK's third national lockdown. And our good friend Kakat has a few thoughts about it.
I'm starting to really get the pucks with this lockdown shit about 3.0.
I'm gonna lose my job.
Don't you know the government are locking us up? So why the fuck you trying to act like you're up in the club?
References to the government locking us up, partying during the pandemic.
It's almost like traumatic right there.
And I'm just sat here thinking, why is anyone listening to this in late 2023? Don't we just want to put all that stuff behind us now? Why am I listening to a song about 2021 lockdowns in 2023? Oh, and it's not the only dated thing here.
About 3.0.
I'm gonna lose my job.
Okay, so that's a reference to Bald Nonce, which was this big British meme thing back in like 2019. As far as I'm aware, it's already a bit of a dated meme, and yet here it is in a UK top 40 hit in 2023.
Well, she pulled up in a vest, looking like a big Les, trying to get the singing Roger and I get the popcorn.
Okay, that's a reference to the Big Les show, you know, that YouTube thing millennials obsessed over in 2014. What the hell is this song?
Loving up the marijuana, right? Worried about him, boy, the chav is a nana.
Chav? I don't think I've heard that.
Who the fuck uses Chav in 2023, man? Fucking hell.
I don't think Kakat is too untalented. Some of the bars are admittedly half clever, which is why it's not super high on my list, but some of the other ones are just what? There's bars on here about having sex with girls he's unattracted to, sucking his left bollock because she's very specific. I get this song was viral mostly because people were somewhat mocking it. It's been known as a Chava anthem, which I've been told is the new Chav, but either way, it's done way too well for my liking. Also, what differentiates this from these other hip house songs is that he does his own hook, but Jesus, it's annoying.
Tell her touch me, please me, kiss me, please me, I'll give it to you just how you like it, dog.
He's got this kind of mocking accent on here, and he's really hammering it up. Plus the beat, as Ben said, is complete shite, but mostly I'm just in awe at this song's success. Either way, let's leave it in this year, please.
Please.
Now, look, Ben and I have known each other for a couple of years. We're both two different people with differing opinions on music, but what surprised me is that we generally disliked a lot of the same music this year. And there's very little on this list that either one of us actively likes, but I knew before I even showed him my list that there was one song we were going to disagree on pretty greatly.
We only got tonight, and I want to spend it by your side.
Now, look, Martin, I know, I get why you would hate this, but I'm not going to say this song isn't smart or intelligent or anything, but it's not that bad. For what it is, it's just a really perfectly serviceable, maybe even good house song for me. I mean, I'm not the type of person who automatically hates whistling in music like you do. If done well, it could add some touches to the song that make it quite fun, and this for me is the sort of a song where it works quite well. I like the melodies too, the production is upbeat and not really all that distracting. I really like the bridge, and Callum Scott sounds fine enough if a bit yelpy. Spot. I'm prepared for Mode's many, many words on the song. I can't hate it though. I'm sorry, mate.
Just put your hand on your heart and whistle.
So this is a bit of an oddity because I have been talking about pop music for 7 years now, and that is pretty much the exact same amount of time that Jax Jones has had a stable career, and I detest his music. I'd argue he's one of the most consistently terrible acts of recent years, but I've never been pissed off enough about a song of his until this one to put it on a worse list. Jax Jones doesn't give a shit about his music. He only cares about the numbers. Personally, I wouldn't have an issue with that if it wasn't for how awfully derivative it has been from the start. Literally, the first song I ever reviewed on YouTube was Jax's 2017 hit, You Don't Know Me, and I couldn't stand it. Since then, he's had a bunch of hits, and except for his work with Martin Solvig, I've never been able to tolerate any of it. Everything he's done is a shallow facsimile of whatever else is big in the mainstream dance scene. He's literally England's David Guetta.
Come on,
yes, he is. He's England's David Guetta. But Guetta at least has the ability to release one good song every year or so. The best Jax has done was a bloody Instruction. So ultimately, my placement of this as the third worst song of the year is partly down to a bit of boiled over distaste of his back catalogue, but I would still argue that Whistle is the worst thing he's ever done. And that's because it's a thuddingly boring piece of nonsense combining two of the absolute worst trends in music at the time of its release. The first of those trends was the continuation of the dead subgenre of 2020's house music called slap house. This is the style of house music that's extremely heavy on the use of bass and its drop and nothing else. Think Breaking Me, Roses, the like. It was a boring genre that ran out of potential for ideas partway through 2021. And by 2022, I had considered it the worst subgenre of house potentially ever. This decade's version of Big Room, but somehow even more laughably lazy. The second of these trends was the short spike in whistling songs that came about in the wake of I Ain't Worried, and yes, that did actually happen. Now, I've already voiced my general dislike of whistling in music before, but combined with a slap house bass, it creates my pick for the worst drop of the entire year. See you. Look, we all hear music in different ways, but when I hear this, I feel nothing. I feel like I should feel something, but I feel absolutely nothing. Like, in the same way that injecting something of pH 1 and pH 14 in the same spot won't lead to any pain. The whistling sounds absolutely pitchy and awful, yet the slap house bass is so mind-numbingly dull that they completely cancel out. And because of that, this drop is the definition of not catchy. Which doesn't make any sense. The annoying thing about whistling is it's an attempt to get the most irritating melody stuck in your head. But when I think of this song, I think of the pre-chorus melody instead. What a complete waste. But speaking of the pre-chorus, oh Scott, how I stood up for you. I've hinted at it before, but screw it, I'll just say it bluntly. Dancing on My Own, the Callum Scott cover, it's fine. It's not great, but I don't agree that it misses the point. I think it's a good description of how the character feels on the inside when they see their ex kiss someone in the club. Either way, I thought he was fine. And then he had Where Are You Now, which was excellent, and even haters of Dancing on My Own have to admit it's at least decent. I stood up for him, he's fine, but this? This is the complete wrong kind of performance of what he's singing about. Baby, if we only got tonight, then I wanna spend it by your side. Don't get me wrong, even if it was the right kind of performance, I would still dislike it anyway, because it's a stupid idea for a song. It's about trying to reconnect with an ex, and the way Scott wants to make sure his ex is still interested in trying to make this relationship work is if they put their hand on their heart and whistle. Yes. Like, what a specific dumb way to communicate with someone. Like I said, it's stupid anyways, but if it's going to be stupid, it should be whole hog. Instead, Scott is singing every single line like it's the most meaningful, deep thing he's ever spoke. It's made so much worse. So yeah, just this song fucking sucks all around. It's a meaningless piece of shit that serves no purpose, was forgotten about by everyone, and just wasted everyone's airtime. Fuck this song, fuck this hackman artist for still charting. Number 17.
You got what you wanted to get off your chest? You want me to take over the next one for you?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, what's the... If you ever wanna fall in love, if you ever wanna bet on us. Okay, let me just say that I'm starting to understand these beyond basic UK piano ballads. They're doing the raw basics to serve an audience who wants some emotional depth. They're so broad they end up being relatable to someone, I guess. There's a reason radio plays them in between their upbeat stuff. It shows the human side of people in the industry. That being said, Kian Duke Rowe is just a terrible artist by those standards. I agree with Mode about All For You. If it wasn't for Ella Henderson, that song would be absolutely irredeemable. But this is honestly pretty damn bad too. If an improvement, I'll give him that. I will admit the production is not bad, there's some decent swell, something going on at least, but Jesus Christ, these are such misguided lyrics, it's unreal. Baby, if you don't cross the line, you'll end up right back where I'm standing. For a song about how long he'll wait for his ex to return, it's weirdly very pushy and projecting on the verses where he's complaining about everything this partner did and has done since they ended things. Yet it's all going back to I'll Be Waiting, which is so messy and devoid of any sort of sense that it just ruins the whole damn song for me. I mean, even though All For You was still fucking garbage, at least the writing had some sort of clear mindset. Even if it sounded fake as shit, you can understand how this all panned out. This meanwhile just feels like two different messages being merged together in an ugly way, not helped by Kian being one of the most unconvincing singers in this brand of UK pop. Leave your keys if you're not coming home. Pack your bags full of letting go. Just utterly worthless across the board. I have no respect for this at all. But hey, you feeling better though, mate?
Yeah. Right. Got a lot to say about the next one, so let's talk lovely. About it. Last year, I went to Leeds Festival in the UK for the first time. For those of you who don't know, Leeds alongside Reading Festival are a kind of joint festival event that occur on the same weekend and have the same acts headlining on different days. Leeds is up north, Reading is down south, so usually northerners go up there, but I absolutely loved it. In preparation, I decided to check out every single artist who was playing at the festival, including the ones I wasn't going to see, just to get a taste and maybe discover a new act. I put their 10 most popular songs on a Spotify playlist and put it on shuffle in the months leading up to it. And I've got to say, this is something I should do a lot more often, even for festivals I'm not going to, because I made a lot of nice discoveries. Now, the festival is funded by the BBC, and one of the things that BBC-funded festivals have is their own stage called the BBC Introducer Stage. This is where up-and-coming acts with small followings, including ones who send their songs to the BBC to get noticed, perform. For 2022, most of the artists playing on this stage didn't interest me. It was mostly made up of bedroom pop acts and jamming rock wannabes, but there was one huge exception. An act playing on this stage, and when I heard her, I thought to myself, okay, this artist is going to be a big thing.
It's Pretty Boys, can I come down with you?
Her name is Katie Baser. She's an early 20s solo female pop singer, and unlike every other act on that playlist, every time a song of hers came up, it drew my attention back to what I was listening to. This girl had a lot of potential. She was definitely the most promising act this year. And I didn't like her.
Oh, not another one. Here we go again. How can someone look so pretty but have nothing in their head?
Turns out a couple months later, my prediction came true as she charted on the top 100 right before the festival started, and then a few months later got a top 40 hit. Now, I do have respect for this artist. She certainly caught my attention, but she caught my attention in the way that she was really fucking annoying. Like, the best way to describe Katie Baser is she feels like the product of a test tube baby with equal parts DNA from Ardy, Lily Allen, Anne-Marie, and Cher Lloyd. And if that sounds like a match made in hell, then you are correct.
That sounds fucking garbage, oh my god.
Most of her songs suck. Her first song, Average Student, was so average you'd think she'd never even gone to school. She has a lot of stuff about her haters. Hey, how's it going? Including a song called 2020s, which almost feels like a social commentary until you realize the only issue she seems to have his said haters, and stuffs her songs with a lot of mugging on the mic, white girl rapping, and at times can come off a little bit cringy.
They say, Kate, you, I just speak so loud. I said, I'm always on a mad thing.
Wagwan fam. The first song she charted, X and Y, has a genuinely great main lyric with "You're not my X, you're just my Y," written by the producer Digital Farm Animals. But the rest of the song is the most judgy, mean girl bullshit that just completely ruins it. I will say though, considering how utterly boring and mundane so many of the more recent crop of UK artists have been, I do have a bit of hope for Baser to improve. In fact, at times she can be quite humorous and exuberant. One of the songs she dropped last year, Friendly Sex, is a legitimately great and funny little two-step number where her spunkiness gives the song a lot of levity, but unfortunately the mean girl angle has continued on her biggest hit, Pretty Boys, which is definitely one of her worst songs.
Oh, not another one, here we go again. How can someone look so pretty but have nothing in their head?
Mostly when I hear this song, I think to myself, why would anyone want to make this? I mean, even beyond the subject matter, the song just sounds like a jingle for your local skip hire. But said subject matter is just plainly obnoxious. It is literally her just moaning about all the guys she ends up hooking up with because they're so hot, but also dumb and so incredibly stupid and have no personality. It's literally just a gender swap version of No Role Models by J. Cole, but about 200 to 300% better. So, still fucking awful.
By the way, for someone who claims their partner's a vapid, she certainly doesn't make a good case for herself.
There is no different meaning that wants to be your mother. Don't care about your feelings, just get under the covers.
This literally gives off fuckboy energy, but the genders are reversed, and it's just incredibly unpleasant to listen to, on top of sounding absolutely fucking terrible. Remind me, Mo, why did we let Katie Baser become a thing?
Well, I'll say this, I didn't have the song high on my list because I feel like there is some potential here, but that potential is still yet to be fulfilled. She did release one song this year, which I admittedly found genuinely funny.
Your dad's a dilf. He's a dilf. He's like you on stilts. And I can't take anymore, he should get a divorce.
However, it's mostly been misses this year. The worst thing she made was a remix of Would You Go to Bed With Me by Campbell and Alchemist, which was already the worst drum and bass song to chart this year for turning Touch and Go's Would You into stupid squidgy garbage. But this has her taking the sample way too literally while speed rapping over the drop and being a complete ripoff of Lily Allen to the point where she nicks a vocal melody from her.
Really?
Yeah.
What?
There's no need to get sentimental. You got some chemistry, let's get experimental. Rude boy, you look like a smoker.
Baser, if you're watching this, A, you've got new material for your next haters song, but B, I still believe in you, girl. If you're talented, just come up with better ideas next time.
Hey guys, you remember the pandemic, right? You remember being sat at home frustrated while millions died around you. You remember the toxicity of the internet back then. Ugh. Good times, hey. Wanna relive it?
If we ever broke up, I'd never be sad. Think about everything I thought we had if we ever broke up.
Well, that seems to be the appeal of this. A lot of responses to this song are about how it reminds people of the music that was popular in mid-2020, and I absolutely see it too. It has that very specific bedroom quality that songs like Super Lonely, Stunning, and fucking Who's That, What's That had. I beg to ask, why do you want to relive that time? The production of this song makes me feel like my soul is being sucked into a black hole. This utterly colorless set of pads, the way too loud drum preset hammering away its basic rhythm, it's music gray water. And all the grayness does is put focus on the lyrics, where not only do I completely side with the guy in this situation, but I'm also genuinely confused with what the fuck she's talking about. This song is nonsense. I could give you a review of each line, but fuck it. Here's a literal summary of everything she says. Look, boy, I don't understand you, but if you're out here wishing on other girls, you will feel my wrath. Oh, well, I would never hate you. I mean, we have had so many good memories together. Like, we enjoyed songs together. We spent so much time together. But, oh, if we ever break up, I won't ever care about that. Not at all. You put me through so much shit. You want a fancy wedding, and I don't want that. That's really selfish of you to think I'd want that. If you want that, you can pack up your shit and leave. Oh, but if you leave me, I'll tell your dad all your dirty secrets.
If we ever broke up, I'd never be sad. Think about everything that we had if we ever broke up.
None of this makes sense. I think she just scribbled down a bunch of non sequiturs from separate breakup songs so people could relate to the specific lines instead of the song on whole. Not realizing the final product makes her look manipulative as fuck. Now, once again, I do see a bit of potential in this. I think it may be somewhat self-aware, considering the music video literally has her fantasizing about poisoning her partner, which is obviously absurd, let's be real. But this is another young artist who is going to have this one song and absolutely nothing else. Nothing she's released since has caught on. So does she have potential to be good? Who knows? We'll never find out. But hey, if you're watching, feel free to prove me wrong. This one really snuck up on me. I didn't hate it at first, despite who it's by, and it was constantly just around, always there in the middle of the Spotify charts this year. And it's only when I thought about it that I really realized that it truly deserves to be called one of the worst songs of its year.
I mean, it's just really not that hard to slander this one anymore. Tory Lanez is in jail for being a fucking idiot, as he should rightfully be. The majority of the rap and R&B circles want nothing to do with him, so much so that he ditched rap altogether for this blatant Weeknd ripoff that is so incredibly sanitized and bland that it makes my soul hurt. I've heard no shortage of mediocre synthwave songs this year, but none of them felt as blatantly lazy and devoid of any sort of creative merit as this one did. Also, Tory Lanez's vocal inflections during the chorus are just painful. Why did we give this guy a hit after a sentence again?
Calling this a Weeknd ripoff is generous.
True.
Tory Lanez literally admitted that he had been DMing the Weeknd to check out his music. Literally. And I'm sorry, but you can't admit to being this completely and utterly desperate whilst at the same time have a song about what a cool bloke you are. I mean, it's genuinely embarrassing. Lanez has the most blatant anti-charisma imaginable. Always has, really. The way he sucks his own penis on this song is just tragic. It's literally him saying he's too cool to dance, and this girl is all over him, which, by the way, coming from his voice is hard to believe. The thing I've never liked about Tory Lanez is how every time he sings, he sounds like he's putting on the most manic, cheesy smile imaginable. It's really obnoxious. And I'm assuming he was saving up money trying to get Suge Knight's lawyer, so he didn't spend any on this instrumental. This is such a basic 80s throwback composition that you're rocking a very boring B minor A, G, B minor chord sequence. Sure, I didn't like the instrumental on If We Ever Broke Up at all, but at least it used decent chords, not this. The synth itself sounds kind of broken, the distorted drums sound more unintentionally shoddy than done as a cool effect. And I'm sorry, but you can't tell me that he didn't just find these random saxophone solos lying around on YouTube somewhere. Like, there's no actual credit for who played them, by the way. So yeah, this just sucks all around, and the sooner it can be gone from the streaming charts for good, the better. Just listen to The Weeknd instead. It's not funny.
Peaches, 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 peaches.
Look, I feel like this is a sort of song where it was kind of obvious that it was gonna suck. It's basically Bowser's fan fiction over Peach put into music, and given Jack Black has a really bad habit of overselling the vocals on any song he does, it was just gonna sound really forced, especially given the Mario movie is reportedly aimed more at kids. So I get why it'd be too obvious for a list like this, but it really is that bad. Firstly, Jack Black puts on these stupid vocal inflections where it maybe got a chuckle the first time, but has zero replay value for me, especially not helped by the composition being so basic and devoid of anything interesting where you just have to focus on those awful vocals the whole way through.
Oh, peaches, 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 ah!
Thank God it's short, but again, not short enough.
Look, I may piss people off for this, but there's something I want to rant about. I get people like the Mario movie, which is fine. But I don't know why so many fans of this movie sink to the level of acting like it can't be criticized. There's a very disappointing rhetoric I've seen over and over again online, to the point where there was even a Meat Canyon video making fun of it, which I agreed with. Because if you enjoyed the film, cool. I mean, I personally couldn't even get halfway through, but there's nothing wrong with me not liking it. I only bring this up because this kind of defense has been used for this song too. I've seen people say it shouldn't go on a worst list because it's a joke song for kids, which I think is a bit of an insult towards the concepts of jokes and kids. I've even seen some say that it wasn't meant to go viral, and that opinion needs to be stamped out because it's objectively incorrect.
Absolutely.
You don't film a lyrical Lemonade video of this without the intent of going viral. This was full-on viral marketing, the most blatant attempt I've ever seen since Pen Pineapple Apple Pen. And it's all for the most basic joke ever. Yes, fine, it's a kid's song, I'm not gonna look too deep into the lyrics, although it's dumb that Bowser would sing "A Thousand Koopas Couldn't Keep Me From You as the King of the Koopas," but Jack Black's voice, on the other hand, can only be described as audio ketchup, in the sense that it overpowers everything and is fucking horrible.
Princess Peach, at the end of the line, I'll make you mine! Oh.
I just don't understand. This was the worst noise to hit the top 40 this entire year. And maybe I would find this at least a little funny if we lived in a world where Lewis Capaldi didn't exist. And by the way, Capaldi dropped an album this year. It had hits including another Someone You Love ripoff that topped the chart. And yet, I would much rather listen to that 10 times over than this one. Hey guys. Guess who's back on the list this year?
Yeah. Pussy like a work of
art. Wetter than the Noah's Ark. This was not a good year for UK rap in the mainstream. And I think one strong indicator for that was how, after their huge 2022, where they got 2 year-end hits, D-Block Europe only got one true hit song this year, despite releasing another 24-song mixtape. I mean, they technically had their biggest ever song with the Ferrari Horses TikTok remix, but no one cared about that song for them. And I've got to say, I personally don't hate this one. It's kind of muddy and the bars are weak, but I don't mind the composition. You got anything you want to say about it, Ben?
Oh, I've got a lot of words for this one. Even as someone who doesn't listen to UK rap often, it just baffles me that D-Block Europe is one of the biggest names coming out of it, because I've genuinely not enjoyed a single song that they've charted. A lot of it comes down to Young Ads being one of the most punchable frontmen in UK rap. I really can't stand his tone even on their best songs. But Pakistan is by far the worst one that they've charted, entirely down to the awful auto-tune, the atrocious production with the gunshot sounds next to one of the most dead beats I've heard in this genre, and also I really don't need to hear them talk about when the girl calls him a dog and he tries to save his number under Labrador. That's Drake levels of cringe. Also, Mode, who the hell is this Clavish guy? He sounds fucking awful.
It's a real shame to me that in its current state, Clavish of all people is the one newcomer in the UK rap scene to have a thriving charting career. He is the absolute last UK hip hop artist I'd recommend to anyone who wants to get into the genre. And yet he had 9 charting songs. Seriously, go listen to Traumatize. It's a song where he samples fucking Thong Song and makes it sound like this.
Don't bother saying, I'm way too sly, even when I don't pack my bags, I'm border plane.
His voice is awful, his lyrics are consistently boring, except for on this one where he compares himself to Joe Biden and acts like that's a compliment.
Lines like that push an already bad song down on this list. It's absolutely a mess. Next! Everything that needs to be said about this song and Jazzy as an artist can all be summed up in Mode's summer ranking video. So given how little effort Jazzy actually put into this song, we're gonna reward it with barely any substance in this segment. Moving on.
it's a comment.
Who gives a fuck?
One thing that has surprised me in recent years, which doesn't get as much coverage as I thought, was the complete fall off of Jess Glynn. And sure, Glynn was a very radio carried artist. She never had many vocal fans. Her fan base was probably made up of 8-year-olds and their mothers. But her fall off was a little disheartening because it was due to her standing up to a record label who wanted Jess to make the same shitty radio schlock, which even she was sick of. She's actually released some music this year, and it's not too bad, but only one song charted. And even then, it was at the bottom of the charts for like a week. Jess Glynn fulfilled a role as a big moneymaker by being a lyrically platitudinous but competent singer, and now there's space for another artist to take that role. Who's it gonna be? You know that I'll be
See, for me personally, this one really stings because I really like some of Tom Grennan's hits. All These Nights is one of my favorite charting songs of last year, and his collab with Joel Corey still holds up as legit great. That being said, this is such a backslide into the sort of corporate blandness that even some of his early songs like Little Bit of Love went down, and man, this whole song just sounds awkward as all hell.
Indeed it does. Here is literally everything I ever said about I'll Be There, but 10 times worse. Fuck, the chorus is literally him just saying, I'll be here for you, on repeat. Tom said he wrote this song to try and help people get through the current tough times we live in, and like, really Tom? You're gonna help pay for my electricity bills? Gonna get some groceries for me? Obviously I'm being a bit bad faith, but come on, that's the kind of thing you say when you write a load of nothing and try to pass it off as having a meaning. Heck, there were loads of songs on the radio at the time this was big with the exact kind of I'll be here for you sentiment that did exactly that and were actually about something. Don't you worry about tomorrow. God, baby. This is just the worst of UK pop music. Rubbish, vague lyrics, terrible over-singing, even the production. That's the one thing Grennan usually has, good instrumentals, but this one is just dire. Over-compressed, ugly trap percussion, fucking slow, basic piano line. It actually sounds really downbeat. It's about Grennan trying to lift you up.
I'm not remotely lifted up by any of this. What the hell?
Absolutely not. It's the worst thing he's ever done. Honestly, I was starting to like him less than even Capaldi at this part of his career. But by the looks of it, this is what Tom's role is going to be. Give up the somewhat interesting lyrics of some of his previous songs for a living and just go to make this nothing music for no one. Do better.
He's done. Anyone feel a bit uneasy?
Baby, you're 22. Tú atajando.
This one just sounds awful. The muffled keyboard, the total lack of atmosphere, the really cheap percussion that sounds like a first draft. This whole song just sounds really unpleasant.
For me, it's not just the sound. Look, I was 22 for most of the year, and I'm totally okay with dating older people. I don't really care for that judgy stuff when it comes to age gap relationships, but one thing that skeezes me out is when people get off on fucking people of a certain age. There's nothing to this girl other than her being 22, and with these really tense chromatic chords and J.O.'s slimy delivery, it feels like an old man eyeing me down, and I hate it. I'm in your city, I'ma show you what it means to be loved. And I don't actually know how old he is. Heck, he's probably younger than 22, but he still comes off like a 47-year-old perv. Oh, and also, it doesn't help that the rest of the lyrics suck. Girl, I wanna handle you. Put my hands upon you, baby. Okay, never mind how he rhymes handle you. Handle in itself is just a really off word to describe someone you want to get with.
It sounds like you're being tossed around. That's just not good.
Exactly.
Girl, I really know your type is me.
Wow, what a charmer.
You look prettier when you're fucking with me.
Yeah, real charmer, this lad.
Wondering if you and I could be.
This song came out this year, by the way. The fuck is he on about?
If you're comparing yourself to Kanye West in 2023, you might need a little bit of professional help. Just saying.
Oh, you thought we were only gonna have one Drake song on this list, did you?
Yeah, I don't be giving up, but I don't know what to call it.
I'll be giving up fuck.
Okay, well, we'll get this out of the way first. Both Ben and I know why this was big. It was a TikTok meme because everyone was clowning on Drake sounding gay, which is like the second time in the past 12 months that the most popular song from a Drake album was because he sounded unintentionally gay.
Fuck. I say whatever I want. Yeah. I do whatever I want. I kind of love money for fun. You know, popping me perjure for fun.
It's particularly funny in this case because this is barely a Drake song.
Drake, don't ever go on a rage beat again. You're not good at it. Hell, your good old friend and collaborator here, Yeet, isn't good at it either. And it's not like Yeet has no good songs. I do unironically really like Flawless and Money So Big, but his complete lack of personality and competent production really does make his music utterly interchangeable. I struggle to remember any of his other songs at all, and this somehow blends into them just as badly.
I hear this though and I think, wow, the SoundCloud era never truly ended, eh?
Benny X.
Seriously, what is this? What the hell is this? Look, I've tried to get into the rage stuff. It's cool to have a newish style of music to get hyped to, but I'm still not too on board yet. I didn't mind Fiend, but this thing is just ridiculous. Sounds like a trap beat put underneath some badly mixed drafts of a 2008 crunk song. I'm kind of at awe at how ugly it sounds, but honestly, the thing I hate the most about it is the ridiculous butchering of the lovely 1970s jazz sample. It's the worst, most confusing transition I think I've ever heard in any song ever. And that pissed me off enough to have it on my list, but then there's this Yeet guy, and I'm sorry, the song should have gone viral for this bit. Sorry, did a pigeon fly in the studio? But I don't want to hear this anymore. We'll just go on to the next song. Come on,
please.
Like most of our rappers are signed to the streets. Only dealers we took was a plea. My boy and money, Wally P. Shout out my label, that's me.
Oh, anyone going to disagree with this placement? Are you? No? Okay, moving on.
Okay, I've got a point to make.
What is love?
So I know Ben hates I'm Good, a lot of you did, I see why, but I found the song a little charming. I didn't really hate it too much. Plus you got to admit that its success was kind of natural. It was just something that happened to get popular on TikTok without a label push. So Guetta said, you know what, let me finish this. And that's how it became big. But come on, this is David Guetta we're talking about.
Shout out to his family.
David Guetta. The man with the least shame in the mainstream electronic music scene. The man who lost his dignity all the way back into 2000.
Bananas.
Everyone knew he was going to do the same thing again, and everyone knew it was going to be way worse. What is
I mean, this just sounds blatant as all hell, and doesn't even have the benefit of sampling a good meme. Instead, he sampled What Is Love by Hathaway, a song that was originally really damn good, but got ruined by really underwhelming memes across the years, and would you look at that? The desperation is already showing through on the second attempt.
I have this derogatory term I sometimes use. Gym house. Basically, there's no particular style for gym house. It's just a term I throw on for any kind of mid-paced electronic music that leaves you feeling very cold. The kind of thing that has a beat so you'd play it in the gym, but nothing of substance worth directing focus on. I mean, this drop, how does it make you feel? Excited?
Nope.
Elated?
Nuh-uh.
It makes me feel drained. I feel the color draining from my face when I listen to it. Funny enough, it reminds me less of I'm Good and more Feel This Moment. Not just because they bastardized a great song, but because they took the best part of that great song and made it sound rubbish.
This whole song just feels so soul-sucking when you hear it. Hell, I've been to clubs where this completely lifeless dreck has gotten more people off the dance floor than actually dancing. And admittedly, then the DJ has to put on Mr. Brightside to try and boost the mood again, and it does work, but still is depressing to watch.
There's just nothing novel about any of this. There's nothing smart or tasteful about replacing Hathaway's beautifully understated lyrics with Anne-Marie sounding bored out of her ass, detailing the most generic push-pull relationship ever. There's nothing funny or clever about getting Coi Leray to have a guest feature where she raps about coming.
Nothing stronger than you when I'm sipping, I'm still gonna finish, I'm drunk, I ain't had enough.
But hey, don't worry, if you want Anne-Marie actually sounding engaged, she had hits this year as the lead artist. Problem is, one of them is this.
That's unhealthy, then I don't give a damn. Cause even if it kills me, I'll always take your hand.
So one one of the weirdest trends in the UK was that country music started to chart quite frequently. It was a little odd seeing Morgan Wallen and Luke Combs in the UK top 40 this year, but hey, it happened. Country is not well appreciated in the UK from my knowledge. Everyone I know thinks it's crap and a bit of a joke, which I don't agree with. So I was happy seeing some of these acts getting a bit of success, but we just still can't take it seriously. This was bigger than any of those country songs, and it's a joke. The whip sounds, the awful fast-paced hand clap percussion, and for what? There's no reason for this song to sound the way it does, other than as an attempt to trend ride. It's a song about being in a toxic relationship, and there's no subversion or anything. It's literally just, all these people in my life tell me my boyfriend's an awful person, but the sex is just so good, I don't give a damn.
It's particularly jarring having production this upbeat next to this sort of content, especially on the pre-chorus where they're openly acknowledging that their sisters are telling them to leave, only for them to act clueless, then backtrack to the hook by antagonizing everyone else for trying to end the toxic relationship. It's just really unpleasant and gets particularly cringeworthy hearing Shania Twain, in her late 50s nonetheless, talking about the pleasure of having red eyes and no sleep. You'd think she'd know better than that at this stage in her life and her career.
This body high gives me sleepless nights. It's a million times when it jerk with you.
People tell me this was the best song off Anne-Marie's album. I haven't heard it, but I don't agree. Sure, you can berate songs like Psycho and Sad Bitch, but those songs are at least interesting. This, on the other hand, leaves no impact. It might as well be by Imagine Dragons or One Republic. Worst hit she's ever had. Oh God, what is this?
Cause I've been trying to figure out why you're still in my mind.
My God, KSI, what the hell happened? You came off a pretty damn good run with Not Over Yet and Summer Is Over, and your last notable release is this? I mean, I get that Oliver Tree was a big name at the time, but given how this was literally 2 to 3 months after the Miss You drama, was this really the name you wanted to collaborate with? Seriously? It's not even to do with his music that's been consistently fucking awful for the past few years. You're willingly enabling the guy who worked with Robin Scholes, the same motherfucker who stole the remix of Jerk and officially released it without any sort of consequences financially. Is this really the guy you want to platform? Doesn't help that the song is just dog shit and easily the worst song that KSI has ever charted with.
I don't get why KSI fans keep wanting him to sing. He has the most feeble tenor imaginable. He just sounds like a little kid. And look, I don't get the appeal of Oliver Tree at all. I know he's been at it for a long time, I just don't see the hype. Everything I've heard from him sounds like a throaty imitation of Juice WRLD stuff. I've certainly never found him a likable presence either.
I tell myself it's fine, another one night stand will do. I'm turning out the lights, so it's dark inside my room. And then I close my eyes, pretending that it's you.
That's disgusting! What the fuck? Why would you say that out loud? Jesus. Well, you know what, Ollie? If you want my advice on getting over your ex, then maybe you should stop making the same thin new metal garbage that she does.
Hey guys, it's Zeroman here, just editing this in post, and both me and Mode agreed, obviously since Mode's not here, that we would make this particular segment its own separate video. This song discussed some very sensitive topics, including these. We figured it would just bring down the whole mood of the video, and we would swap it over to somewhere else. If you want to watch this segment, the link to it is in the pinned comments as well as the description. Let's just say it wasn't a particularly pleasant segment, and for this type of video, even if it is talking about the worst, this song just talks about way too much that's way too serious for this sort of video. But yeah, back to the video.
Right, before number one, we have a bunch of honorable mentions that made our own individual lists that we wanted to voice our opinions on.
One line.
Okay, fine. I don't care about your rapist husband, Nikki.
Married a shooter in case you niggas tried to breathe loud. Boom your face off, then I tell him ceasefire.
I'm sorry, but while I get the appeal of this song and how much Olivia wants to tear down this awful ex for everything he did, it gets ridiculously oversold to the point where I just don't buy it at all, especially with this production being so theatrical and crap. Also, Bloodsucker, Fame Fucker.
I know, this is supposed to be Ben, but this is the worst writing Olivia's ever had on any of her songs. I don't like it. It's not very good. Jazzy is genuinely one of my least favorite new artists. She completely lucked her way to success by singing on a stolen song, got another big hit this year with the same kind of mediocre house schlock, and then charted this, her worst sounding song to date. It was produced by Hannah Lang and DOD, two artists who had pretty good trance tracks this summer, and you can tell they didn't have much freedom here because if they had any faith in this lame, awful sounding instrumental, they would have stuck their names as feature credits. Picking out this dress,
trying on these shoes. I'm sorry, Selena, but peppy upbeat delivery for a song about how you're gonna be single soon just makes you look like a total tosser. God, you know the song is bad when I have to use British insults for the... Just, let's move on. I got hoes, might just be
on in different area codes. This is pretty much just a more rhythmical version of Cash Shit by a less established act. Pretty awful, but ultimately too cute to get pissed over. I left my yard filled in the
50s, didn't remember my bank cards. I've started realizing that the only time I've truly liked Heady One is when his verses are sampled in dance tracks, especially from Fred Again, because stuff like this really bores the hell out of me. He doesn't even have the witty writing or sharp flows to help him with this one. It's just a mediocre song across the board. The devil in me, demon in me, at 6
but I let go free. Tell my bridge and let go of me. He said calm down, there's no need. Jay Huz's album was pretty decent, but this is my pick for the worst song he's ever done. Never been able to buy him as a particularly hard or angry guy, and I buy it way less with this fucking Central C ass beat behind it. You ain't gotta worry about
nobody else's. Oh, and speaking of Central C, this is just weak across the board. Sloppy flows, boring production, cringe-worthy lyrics, it's just not fun at all, and a total dirge for me. I already know that it's not
you. I never did watch The Idol. I had the opportunity to many times, but seems like a real waste of time. Anyway, this song turned me off from it very quickly. It just sounds like an unfinished pop rap song for 2008, but with a trap beat underneath it. Plus, Abel's lyrics are the most derivative version of his own content he's ever tried to sell. I'll be honest.
Looking at you got me thinking nonsense. Sabrina Carpenter sounds so weak vocally here that I highly believe she actually caught chickenpox during the recording session. I mean, why else would she mention it here? My dick just got hard
cause a wire just hit. You're not hard, Drake.
So people seem to really like this undercooked fragment disguised as a big collab between the King of Rage and the man we suddenly decided to embrace again for no reason after 2021. I think it's absolutely worthless and by far the worst song in Utopia. Also, Playboi Carti sounds like he's taking a shit on the hook. Next. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low.
Only hate the roads where you're missing home. This would have been number one if I didn't mention it in my list last year. Because Jesus Christ, how on earth did he think any of this content was a good idea? New to a rural village, you made me delete that pic on my
phone, but I close my eyes to see that image. Why? I just can't. Why just can't. Are you saying that? Just why fucking... the fuck are you saying
Now, before Ben sent me his own list, I already knew which song was going to be number one. If anything, it would have topped my own personal list, but it's such a blatantly obvious choice that it almost feels like the artist is trolling. This song wasn't a hit in the US, but I reckon most of you have heard of it because it went somewhat viral. But it did chart in the UK and Australia for a while. So I feel like if people were to make a worse list with these rules, this would have been their number one too. But there was no other song that charted this year that was so aesthetically tasteless, and so incredibly devoid of wit and charm. And it can only come from the mother herself. Welcome back to the list, mate. I am your mother. I am your mother. You listen to me.
Stop all that mansplaining. No one's listening. So I've been holding back throughout the year with actually listening to this song in full. Quite frankly, I have no idea how, considering radio actually got on board with this here, which for someone who was working at adult contemporary radio in 2023 is somehow miraculous. But given Meghan Trainor hasn't made a single song I've considered above decent, and that title just seems like the sort of Twitter bait for the remaining fans she has who genuinely enjoy simping over someone who acts like this.
They're like, yeah. This is what it's like to have a kid in school in America. I have a bulletproof backpack. I was like, that.
Like that, but also bullying. Kids can be mean. Teachers, that was my teachers. Trauma. Teachers,
you know, dude. But then. I literally said, F-teachers.
Could you blame me for avoiding this? So in the build up to this video, I decided to finally submit and actually hear this, and oh my God. I've not heard a song that sounded like it was completely designed to appeal to everything I didn't like in music. This song is beyond unlistenable, and every time I think about it, it makes my skin crawl in disgust. I'm not even the biggest fan of Major Look either for the same cringeworthy synth baiting, but at least that one was actually catchy and at least had some decent vocal melodies. You could reasonably understand why that song revived her career. Let's get the smaller issue out of the way first. The production sounds borderline unfinished, relying far too much on the Cordet sample that's mixed horribly with the bass heavy house adjacent percussion that just sounds like the worst elements of the modern dance music scene mixed with TikTok pandering.
It just sounds disgusting, like self-evidently. And the way the sample is used is borderline offensive to me, especially when she interpolates the bum bum part to say you're just the bum bum, like one of the worst moments in music this year.
But what makes it worse, as you'd expect, is the lyrical content. And look, I'm not against women making more music, raising the middle finger towards dismissive and arrogant assholes. I get why Trainor thought this would be a good idea that she could explore, but my god. In practice, it's the worst fucking execution of it. I mean, not only do lines like "you with your god complex, but you can't even make life fish" feels incredibly hypocritical given the opening vocal sample from a diehard fan on TikTok directly calling her mother in a Queen context, gross.
The fact that Meghan Trainor is literally mother right now.
But on that same verse, she also mentions this supposed guy trying to control her like an old man on C-SPAN.
Ain't trying to control me and own me like an old man on C-SPAN.
Which not only is an awful line, but also forces the comparison between this guy and a channel showcasing HOR and Senate meetings, where it's apparently saying that the guy past his prime can't control what she says, but it just comes off pitiful.
Oh, and by the way, Meghan, you can't even make life, bitch.
But you can't even make life, bitch.
It takes two to tango, Meghan. Unless if secretly all this time you've been some kind of weird alien aphid thing or something that could just self-produce. Probably explains why he released Me Too.
But what really made me actively despise the song was that goddamn hook. Where the bass overpowers the mix, Meghan Trainor's own backing vocals are so tinny and annoying, and since the song never actively addresses what these men said to piss her off, the whole "stop all that mansplaining" line just comes off in really bad taste and makes me feel sick whenever I hear it. It's not even that we're not the target audience for this, obviously, we're not. But you'd think it would not be hard to actually detail what these sexist men actually said. Ramp up the drama of the whole thing, put them on wax, expose how stupid their reasoning is. And given how badly the song flopped after hitting the top 40 in the UK charts, it's very clear that this anti-social, badly misguided approach had yielded precisely zero cultural impact and really ended any sort of revival for Meghan Meghans in 2023. Congratulations! Well done there.
You done mansplaining?
So, special thank you to Mode for coming along. It's been an absolute pleasure doing this with you. And yeah, glad that we actually were able to meet up and make this happen. And yeah, if you guys have any other songs that you think should have been on this list, please let us know in the comments down below. Mode, do you have anything to say?
Yeah, just thank you so much, Ben. Thank you just for letting me come here and just make a video and stuff. Yeah. Ben's a good guy, you know. And good way to spend a Sunday too. And also check out, because I know some of you, Ben's channel, it deserves more popularity. He does his own an analysis of dance video where he talks about the Billboard dance charts every week. Real devotion to that, and I love it. It's really good. But anyway, thank you guys so much for watching, and I hope you guys have a good 2024.
Last Christmas, I pulled up an aim, but the very next day, that need ran away.